Hello to today's webinar about secure offline and online updates for Linux devices. Before we get started, we will talk about a few administrative things. So, for example, we will have a Q&A at the end, and you can use your chat box to type in your questions. We will see that at the end, and we'll be able to answer it. You can also use this chat box if you have any questions about technical setup, you can't hear us, or you have any issues or any feedback, make sure you type that into this box. With that, let's get started. So first, let me introduce myself here. So my name is Daniel Lang. I am the Chief Marketing Officer for Toradex and also a Head of Product. I'm with Toradex for about 16 years. My background is in software development. I did that for many years before I went into marketing. So today we will talk about offline updates and online updates. But we will start with a very brief introduction about Toradex so you get the context in case you're not familiar with us. Then we will talk about why offline updates. We will look at common offline update system. We see in the market, a lot of our customers are using that. We will talk about a way to provide very secure offline updates with our Torizon platform. We will have a demo where you really see hands-on how that works, what you have to do, what's kind of the ease of use. And then we have a Q&A where we will answer all your questions you had while we're doing the webinar. So first, a brief introduction about Toradex, in case you do not know who we are. So our main goal is make embedded computing easy, and that also includes IoT application. How we do that? We do that with very reliable ARM system on modules, and we have our Linux IoT platform softwares to help you to make your life much easier. We believe you have the lowest cost of ownership in the market, and that doesn't just mean the cost of the hardware or cost of a certain service. It means the whole product life cycle from development effort, time to market, maintenance in the field, and so on. There we believe you have very good value. Also, we're very proud of our industry-leading support. We are actually just launching a new developer website. So if you already know it, we have a developer website with over 800 articles. And we have a new framework, so it's new structured, so it's easier to find all these articles. And if you want to give it a try, go on our developer website. There's a banner on top, and you can get a preview on our new website. And you know, we are happy feedback. Good. I think it's always interesting to understand what's the focus market of a company so you understand why we do certain trade-offs or what we are focused on. So our typical application includes industrial automation, healthcare, transportation, test and measurement, and smart city. And as you can see, all of these applications, they need high reliability, they need high security, and that's really something where we're strong and where we have a strong focus on. Also, the volumes are interesting. So our typical application have from a few hundred to a few 10,000 devices per year per product. But we also have a smaller customer and we have a few bigger customers too. So here, just an overview about our hardware modules we provide. We will not go in detail here. You can see three families. All the families are pin compatible within the family, so you can upgrade and downgrade. And what's important, we will talk a lot about software today, but what's important is because you also do the hardware, we can really provide it a full stack, we can test everything, and it's not like it's probably a hardware problem or it's a software problem. We can really take advantage of all special features like neural network processor, security feature, watchdogs, and so on in these devices. What we will talk a lot in this webinar is about the software part. That's maybe a little bit newer if you're familiar with Toradex. Toradex is always very strong on software. We always have about 90% of our engineering in software, initially Windows CE, now a lot of Linux, so a lot of optimization. We do upstreaming, a lot of bootloader contribution and so on to provide you a very good software. But now we even extended that a little bit with Torizon platform. And here, just very brief few of the components. So we have a lot of value for developers. So we have our operating system, which built with Yocto. So you have our Yocto PSP, but you can also now use a binary distribution, which is fully tested every 3 months. You get a lot of additional packages from Qt for UI, Crank, Codesys for soft PLC. We work with Ozone and others for machine learning. So we really accelerate your time to market. Also, as a developer, we have integration with Visual Studio, Visual Studio Code to provide you very easy to use and very modern and productive tooling. Then we have this Torizon platform, which allows you to do over-the-air updates, so remote updates to devices in a very secure and very reliable way. And of that, we will talk much more. But I also here want to show we have also a channel back. So we have device monitoring. There was just a webinar a few weeks ago. If you didn't see that, I recommend you to check that out. You can learn how you can monitor the device and also how you can monitor custom variables and custom events there. And then the idea is you get this feedback. You can improve your product with this information and make it better, iterative, so you can use modern DevOps, modern Agile development. What we will focus on today is actually a new way how you bring the software to the device. So from the Torizon platform, how you can deliver it to your end device, even if they're not connected. Good. So now, next topic is, why should we even do updates? Just in general. And I hope a lot of you have, you know, your own motivations, but here a few from our point of view. Everyone, you can fix issue. Software is never 100% bug-free, and maybe it's not even your software, it's you know, a package library you use, you can fix that. Security, very, very important nowadays, especially if your devices are connected. Many times now it's even required, so there's a lot of new regulations coming. Many of them have requirements on security, right? Don't use default password, but also you have to be able to update that because you need to use newest kernel, you need to be able to patch the operating system applications and so on. It also allows faster time to market, so you can actually limit the functionality of a device a little bit. Say, hey, well, that's really important to use the product, and you can have kind of add-on features. You can deliver later, you can see how the market reacts, is that even required, and then provide that gets your product on the market before your competitors. Reaching customer needs. So customer needs may change. COVID was a very good example. People really changed how they worked, how they interacted with devices. Maybe they didn't want to touch it anymore and so on. So if you have update capabilities, you can react to that. And the world is evolving pretty fast. So I think it's a really good thing. And you can innovate faster. You may have good ideas or things you want to try out. You can get it in front of people. You can try it out if you want to roll it out. You don't need to wait 2 years until there's a new hardware revision or a month until you know you have it in the factory, it goes to warehouse, distributed to the customers, you can directly get it to the customers. And there are many, many more. Now, why remote update? So in general, I really think remote update is the preferred way to do that. That's you know, also how we started. And you should really consider if you don't have it yet, if you don't want to implement. So here it's a survey, it's a little bit older from 2017, but we asked 2,000 of our contacts about connectivity. And at that time, we asked about the next project. So more than half said they will connect the devices to the internet. So I think that's huge considering in the industries we are. Even another third said, yeah, we are considering it. You know, they didn't decide yet, but that was definitely on the plan. There was only a little bit more than 10% who said, no, we'll not connect our devices. And I think, again, considering our industry, I think this is very interesting data. So this was a few years ago, and with a lot of people. Now I'm actually interested what you think about updates, remote updates, offline update, and what's your plan. So you should see a poll. Please make your choice. So are you doing remote update? Are you only doing offline updates? You need a mix of both, or is it no? You know, at the moment, I'm interested in that webinar, but you know, I don't think I will use it. Okay, so give you 5 seconds more, and then we will conclude the poll. Here, what we have. So we have most need online and offline, and then there is about equal one with remote, and then we have only offline update, which is probably a little bit higher than in general because that's the topic of the webinar. But it's interesting that most of you really would like to use both. Good. Then let's continue here with our slides. So we're still in the why updates part. So why remote updates and not the offline updates should be the default. So what we think is remote updates, typically they're faster, they're lower cost than on-site where you have to arrive their update, especially of course if your fleet goes up, manually updating 10,000 devices is a lot of work. It reduces maintenance. Again, you don't need to go there. Reduces recall. You can fix stuff remote, so they don't need, use a service technician or a customer do not have to bring in the devices. Increased customer satisfaction. I think that's general, not just for remote updates, but remote updates, it's even more convenience for the customer. You can reduce CO2 emission. You don't need to fly to Alaska to, fix your gateway there or whatever, or at least don't drive there. And there's new business models. I mean, Tesla, probably the most famous one, where you can buy features, you will get it via an update, or you buy something, you will get it future. So there is a lot of new business plans. Some of them may be also applicant for you, and there are many more. So if you have the chance, definitely check if you can do remote updates, and if not, we can also look together, how we can maybe do that. But now, in the title, there was offline update, and we will talk mostly about offline updates. So why no remote update sometimes? Connectivity is not always available. So sometimes the device just didn't have connectivity, right? Maybe when it was designed, that was not a consideration, it's just plain missing. Device location doesn't have connectivity. So there you can think about very remote location, or maybe in a bunker or basement where you just don't have cellular connection or anything. So you cannot do that. Or that's the next point, it's the connection is very expensive. So if you're very remote, you don't have cellular connection, you could use a satellite link, but they're typically very, very expensive. So maybe it's not worth to do the update that way. Also a very common one here, we see security concerns. And certain people, they want to have air-gapped systems. They may still have a network, but it's not connected to the internet. So that's why OTA infrastructure is missing. You may just don't have the capabilities to manage the devices. You need cloud infrastructure and all of that. And of course, if that's the reason, talk to us. Torizon probably can help you there. The last one I listed here is troubleshooting. So sometimes if you're a technician and there's maybe something very weird, or it's maybe still an early process, you want to troubleshoot the device, you wouldn't have the capabilities to updates offline. Maybe there's issues with the connectivity or whatever. So that's a good option to have. Good. Next couple slide is about typically update system we saw in the market. I didn't focus on the most advanced one, really the things you should see up. People normally do that themselves, easy ways to do that. We'll talk later about the variation of that, which is a little bit more complex and also a little bit more security in the other side. So the first one is just a USB stick, you connect it. It's a file-based thing. You normally typically replace some files, shut down the old application, launch the new one. And this is very easy to do. So we see that quite a bit in the market. So that's the big advantage. Simple, it's fast. So that's also probably the reason we see it a lot. These are the security, typically none in there. I mean, you could add a little bit, but probably only patching a little bit, and then very rarely we see that. Other thing we rarely see is good error handling. Something goes wrong, maybe there is a message, but it's normally not a way to get back, or there is a risk that it gets corruption. Many times we like it's best effort, like let's try. If it doesn't go, we send a technician there, or they have to send back system. And the next one, I think here a system can end up in an undefined state. I think this is a very, very important one, especially if you have bigger fleets. So many times these updates, they may seem they functioned, but they maybe forgot to copy a file, or you know, it went wrong, or people disconnected the stick too much. The system may still boot, kind of works, but it's in a different state. Or people have different USB sticks. You send some out, and then now you patch something. You see in another one, or you say the update doesn't work always. So you patch. At the end, you have 1,000 devices with 20, 30, 50 different configuration. And if you begin to have issues or that doesn't work, it's basically very, very hard to manage. And this is the thing we hear a lot, and a lot of our customers are very worried. They want to have reproducibility. So if they have a device out there, they want to know what kind of state, they want to be able to reproduce that. So they can also, if there is an issue, they want to dig down why was the issue, they can do their analytics, fix it. And it's very important if you want to have a reliable products in. Also, here a point, typically most of the system we see here, they only update the application and they don't worry about the OS or bootloader or any other software. Next thing we see here is a recovery mode. So if you don't know what the recovery mode, that's the feature we, for example, used to initially program the modules, and we expose these pins that you can get the system into recovery mode to our customer. And I think most SoC, most embedded system have something like that. You can press it. In our case, with die.mx modules, they will wait on a USB client port to get some data from like a laptop or tooling, and you can program the system and do that. It will delete everything. It will program, and many times people do that. They flash first. In our case, sometimes Toradex is installed and they load another software, then they have to provision everything. It's basically what you would normally do in an automated factory program. So the good thing is in a defined state, right? You're really starting from zero, so you can get the system in a defined state. It's full stack, you can update everything, bootloader OS. It's always possible. So even the system is totally corrupted, that's normally still working. So that's a very nice one, but there's a lot of disadvantage. Again, security, if that's possible, anybody could bring anything on it. So you may want to protect that port or that way, or you can even kind of use it out. It deletes everything, so there's a lot of work. It requires new provisioning. It typically is actually very difficult to do, because you don't want to have a button to put that thing in recovery mode. You want to hide it, maybe protect, maybe you have to open the device and so on. So normally very difficult, needs typically very skilled labor. So you can tell your end customer, the guy working on the machine to update the system, you normally have to send out non-technical, and even it can be in a defined state. If they have to do so many things like provisioning and things, they may make mistakes. If you don't have a process, so at the end you're maybe still in undefined state. So for me, that's more a disaster recovery. If really everything goes wrong for whatever reason, you can do that, but it shouldn't be really used as an OTA system, I think. U-boot script. People use U-boot. You can script there. We definitely saw that people using U-boot. The checks for a USB stick is connected. If there is something, it loads it. Does some update. You can do that. It's OS updates are possible. That's actually a lot how people do OS update. It's much more flexible in the recovery mode. Because recovery mode, you kind of rely on the firmware on the system. What it does. A bootloader, it's already your software, so you have a little bit flexibility. But you can actually add some features for better security or better reliability, but it's up to you. Again, typically most of the stuff you see here, so it's not very secure. Error handling if something goes wrong. And also typically this needs very skilled labor, as you know what you do. Then changing an SD card. This is what you see a lot of maker boards, which completely boots from SD card. You can just replace the SD card. It's a defined state again. You have full control. You can really start over. It's a full stack. You can update everything. If it really boots from the SD card, and it's always possible. Again, if it boots from SD card, you know, they don't rely on the old SD card, even if it's fully corrupted, to get a new one. Again, many times with like Raspberry Pi and stuff, the default one is very not secure. It can be very labor intensive, because if that's the way you update your devices, again, you probably want to protect that's probably another port, you know, outside of the device, you can easily just pop out the SD card, maybe somebody will steal it and your device will not work. So normally that's somewhat protected. It's labor intensive, you also have to program the SD cards, manage the SD cards and all of that. Again, provisioning again, and even you have a defined state, all these steps add ways to getting undefined state or makes mistakes and all of that. And then this is kind of just a little bit about SD card reliability. There are good like military and industrial SD cards, but we see many times people use more like consumer geared SD cards. They may work for a year, two, three, but you know, some menu you're probably gonna run into issues. This is kind of a flavor on the changing SD card. You can actually, in our case, with Toradex models, which is so the or MXM connector, you can actually replace the whole module. We see sometimes that being used like for customer, maybe small fleets. You know, defined stack, you know, everything. You can even, you know, run the models of your factory programming. However, very, very labor intensive, normally even more labor intensive than SD card. It's skilled labor. You have to provision again. So also not a really a thing of more kind of a disaster recovery. Then the next one is SSH serial. I mean, sometimes that's used together with, you know, USB or SD cards. So you log into the device and you basically do manually or scripted updates on the device. We see that a lot. We see that a lot in a proof of concept and if people just have a few fleets out there. You have a lot of control. You can do a lot of things with it. It's fairly simple to do. Disadvantage, again, it can have in an undefined state. There's a lot of steps, a lot of things that can go off. Typically, it's skilled labor, and it's even engineers doing it. You have to manage the access account, you know, secrets, users who can do that, and things like that. And many times it's not done, or it's not done in a very nice way. Also, if you're a serial port or, you know, really go to the device, again, that's maybe protected. It's maybe just a debug serial port you would use for that, which is maybe not that easily available. And so also not ideal here. Good. So I also want to say this is what we see. Many times it's a very you know, simple ways. There is ways to do all of that thing better. And there are frameworks like SW, RAUK. They are update framework, especially SW. It's really also focusing a little bit on offline update. Or you can use technologies like OS3, which is like a Git for a file system. So you can help with reliability. You can have some rollback things and so on. So you can use them to improve your solution. But it's going to be time, and you know, you have to put that in and you have to connect things, and most of them are not focused on security as much as, you know, what you will see from Toradex. But there are better ways also to do that. And I'm not saying all self-made OS updates are bad, totally not, but it's just what we see in customers. Really, many times people are just not so concerned. They just want to update it as fast as possible, and they do not think about all things which are connected with updating in a reliable and secure way. So now that was kind of what I thought you know, could be issues or a few things I highlighted, but now I'm interested, what's the biggest concern for you regarding offline updates? Security, not breaking the device, so make sure the device always, you know, function. Being in a defined state, that means it may still function somewhat, but maybe has some bugs, or, you know, it's just hard to maintain. You're worried that it's a complete stack, so you maybe just want to update your application, you want to have everything, or the usability skill. I mean, it's a guy who really do the updates, you know, you may cannot send your technician, you may need to rely on the customer doing that by himself. So I assume it's more than one you are concerned of, or I hope, but here it's really the one you feel is, you know, the most pressing for you and the one which is the most concerned, so you have to pick one. Good. Here another 5 seconds. And then good. So not pricking the device came up quite a bit. And also the usability is fairly high. But with quite distance, not breaking the device, the usability and the security. And yeah, I can say that's really, really what we hear a lot. I mean, a lot of our customers, their products in, let's say, in the factory line, and if it goes down, doesn't work, they have to stop the factory line, extremely expensive, or they are on railway infrastructure, and they break, they may need to stop a train. So that can be extremely expensive, you know, high value machines, or many times our products in machines, which cost, you know, a lot of money. So if they don't work, a construction machine and so on, it's very expensive. Or just if you have to go there and exchange it, right, you may have to go to a plane, or you may have to get access. So that can cost more than our products typically. Good. Thanks. That was very interesting. Now we talk about a way to do secure offline updates with Torizon. So just very roughly how it works, we'll have a demo later that. But we have a web UI for the one who is using Torizon Online Update, we'll come in familiar with that, where you can figure your update, what you want to update, your OS updates, you know how it's signed, and so on. That's kind of the first part here. Then the second part is the Torizon Core Builder. That's a tooling you can run on a PC, or you know, you could also integrate in CI/CD pipeline, which actually you know, downloads everything. So we use a Docker containerization for software by default. So it will download all the Docker container, all the OS updates, everything you need, and basically put it on a USB stick or SD card. And then you can use that USB or SD card, go to your device, and an auto, fully automated update. If something goes wrong, it rolls back. That's basically, it's very high level, very simplified. There's a lot of security and a lot of behind the scenes here. We'll talk a little bit about it, but we also have all the documentation where you can go really deep if you want to know how that all works behind the scenes. So first, talk a little bit how we assure reliability of the system. And reliability really plays in if you say you don't want to break your device. It's probably the number one you want to focus on. So first, the Torizon OS, if you use that, it's tested by Toradex. So we're not just testing the BSP or the hardware or a piece of software. We test the full stack. Means that the OS, the drivers in there, the whole OTA system, the tooling, it's everything on one hand is tested, and we release a binary image and also a Yocto BSP layer every 3 months, fully tested. We have every month developer drops where you can use and try out the newest feature, and we have nightly builds if you look for a patch or something like that. You're really, really focused on the system always in a defined state. So what you can do is only like step by step, that's defined what states are possible, and it's only there. So you know it's either in state A or B, it's not somewhere between. That really helps maintaining, bringing maintenance costs down. We have an advanced rollback system, so it means if anything goes wrong, people disconnect the USB stick in the wrong moment, or somebody you know, pulls out the power in the wrong moment, or all of this, you know, lots of things can go wrong with application, things like that. We can roll back in a known state, so say A or B, we roll back into to the right one, and so you're sure your device is still working, coming up, and you can try to update again. We use software containerization by default, so you don't have to necessarily need that, but we do that. And that also helps you, for example, if you want to do frequent application updates. So because software containerization puts all your dependency in a container, so you can update. So it's much less likely you break another application, you are less dependent on what's exactly the OS, and you have more control on yourself. So if the container works, this is much lower risk, and it helps to increase reliability. We have an optional synchronous update. That means you can actually define the version of all the software stack, and you see only this is allowed. So for example, you say, okay, I always want to test my My app is extremely good, but I cannot test every application update with every OS update. And I say, hey, if I have application update 5, it has to be OS version 2 and bootloader version 1. And only this is an approved allowed thing. And you have to update everything so there is never a state where, you know, like it runs with another OS or anything like that, because this is in test. So we allow that, called synchronous update. You can define that. Under the hood, we use OS3. As I mentioned, this is Git for file system. And other things you see sometimes is AV updates. OS3 basically provides you the same security, that you have different version, but it's much more efficient in, you know, the file size, so you don't need that much storage. We also use green boot, like, you know, when we boot the system, we make sure everything like works. I suppose if maybe the update was okay, but now your system doesn't boot correctly, then you also want to go back, so we can do that. We even, because you have control about the hardware, we even use a hardware watchdog. So let's say your update really does something crazy, and you know, when you boot next time, it blocks out the whole system for whatever reason. Maybe, you know, it didn't test a certain case. We have watchdog, it will say, oh, something is wrong, reboot the system, roll back, and you're in a defined state, and you can basically try again or fix your update and then go for that. So now security, and probably you could, you know, have an 8-hour work session on that, how it's secured, how it works under the hood. But here, kind of on the high level. So one thing important to understand is our online and offline update system is based on the Uptane Framework. And it's a framework that's used by a car company, German, US car companies. There are universities involved. It's reviewed. So that how we do stuff, it's very, very defined. And it's not just Toradex. This is a secure way. It's really reviewed. This Uptane Framework didn't allow for offline update originally, but we are actually, the things we did, we committed to the framework and we got accepted. So now there is an official way to do offline updates. That's very good. And I think this is a very important part. So we are signing the software and we're signing the instruction. So many solutions actually they sign the software, so you know you can only install stuff which is signed, but we also sign the instruction. So even software is signed, maybe this is, you know, outdated, maybe it's now known that there is a bug in it, or the other reason why you do not want to accept this anymore. That's, for example, a reason why we also have the instruction. So we are making sure also that the instruction are just coming for you. There is a lot of use cases if you go into detail, but that really, you know, removes a lot of attack vectors. It also gives you more option to deal with, you know, if you have new people or, you know, need to change something in the system. We have rollback protection. It's kind of connected. So one attack thing is to use a valid OS update, which had a bug. It was maybe not known when it rolled out, to roll back, so we can protect that. We can evolve the trust store on the device. So you may migrate, maybe there's now new signing keys, you go forward. Every time you do an update, we also update that. It's basically a whitelist which was allowed. So we are kind of moving that forward. You can time limit the update. That's also security. You can say, hey, this update is only valid for a week or a month or a day or just a few hours, so that if it gets out there, you know, it's not misused, or you know, you may don't think about it, what will happen in 3 years. So you can actually limit that. And let me get your key on the side. We support offline key, so when you sign the product, you can do that, your update, you can do that in our web platform and Horizon Core Builder, but we also allow you to take some of the keys offline. So it means even you do not trust that the Horizon online platform is fully secure, even somebody would, you know, get into there, they still couldn't sign an update for you because you would have this key, you know, offline with you. Of course, then you need to take care of the keys, but you know, this could increase security, or if you need to adhere to certain standards. We're working on secure boot integration. So secure boot integration is on the device side that basically in the boot process, you always validate the signature and making sure the next bootloader, so the boot ROM validates the bootloader, also OS application and so on. And you can do that. And a lot of our customers use that, but it's not seamlessly integrated yet. That's something we are actively working on. And here, kind of the last point, kind of stretching over everything. So when we decide that we really always have security in mind and we design it through the whole stack, many solutions you will find, they did something and then they add something, or, they bring in a third party here and, connect stuff, and that's possible. But every time you do that, it adds certain risk on these interfaces, as the system maybe not designed from ground up to work with this other system. And you have to kind of, glue them together. In our case, everything which is included in Torizon is really designed, to work seamlessly together, really increasing the security. Good. Now, to do something very secure, that's one way. And, people can do that. The really, really tricky part is to make it secure, but also make it easy to use. So you want to have a secure system, but you may not want to, do a PhD in, IoT security or something like that, right? You want to make sure you're secure, but you want to be able to use it in a fairly easy way, and you don't want to hire, a whole department just to deal with that. And that's really kind of what we focus on. We have our internal security guys, discussions here are very technical. We deal with Uptane and all of that. But for you, it's much easier to use, and then we really put focus on that. So a little bit, how that allows. So first, you have to provision your devices in the factory or later. We allow that currently. You can do it online or offline. So just offline only. We also will allow both, so you can combine it. And we're also working on better tooling for provisioning at scale. So if you need to program thousands of devices, you want to make sure that's going fast, secure in the factory. And there we have some tooling. So if you're interested in that, you can also review that if you, tell you how we do it. So make sure it works in your factory. And then on the update management, so we have the web UI on Torizon. You can log in, you can manage really your updates. And there is also an API integration. So a lot of our customers, they use Torizon to update and maintain their embedded systems, IoT systems, but then have another cloud platform where they do the data analytics or, what they really do, right? What's their key thing, maybe something about machine learning or, whatever they're doing. But they don't want to, worry too much about them maintaining the system. So you can connect these two systems as our API. You can get, for example, fleet data from us, or we can get the fleet data from you, who owns the devices, where they are, and so on. So this is something we're working on. We have a private one, but we are now working with customers to get this to public. We use something like lockboxes. So when you define your update, it basically goes in a lockbox. We currently do not encrypt it, so you can kind of see what's in there, but you cannot tamper with it, really, with designing, with the instruction and all of that. You have a lockbox and you can securely move it around. People will not be able, to open it up and change the update or introducing a bug or a security issue. So that's kind of a nice concept we use here. It's integrated with Torizon Core Builder. Torizon Core is also the tool you use to make edit to the OS. Maybe you have another display resolution or no display, or you have additional sensors you need to add or additional driver. Instead of having the whole Yocto to do that, we have Torizon Core Builder tool. It makes it much easier. This is a tool we use to actually download all the files, go to Docker and get all the files ready, which you can put on a USB sticker, putting in this lockbox and then it's the USB sticker. We can currently do OS update and application update. We're working on bootloader updates, so you will see that too. So you can update the whole stack. Now, installing the updates. One thing is really creating them and doing that. The other one is really installing them at the device. And I said before, it came several times up, and you're already pretty high up in your survey, is the ease of use. Like the people who go and doing the update, You know, you want to make the life easier. You don't want to get phone calls, stuff. So one thing we do very well, and that's some real problems our customer have, is we protect, again, wrong updates. You may have two coffee machines, a fancy one, the premium, and then one which is maybe very, very similar, but it's the low cost and has all the features. So you want to make sure they bring the right software to the right machine. Or the machines are maybe very different outside, but very similar inside. So you want to make sure nobody mixes up USB sticks and so on. And that's really guaranteed with us. A lot of that comes actually from the security. So you have very control where that goes. It's also possible to do different updates on the same USB stick. They can basically have one USB stick, you know, people go out and they basically cannot update the wrong machines, really reducing your support calls or, you know, your behavior again helps to have everything in a defined state. If stuff goes wrong, we're helping with rollback, basically automatically recovery. Here is maybe the better word. I said several updates on one medium. That's very convenient. You can use USB card, SD cards. It's actually also possible to do it from a local network. It's currently in the very early version, we do not test that much, but we definitely see a request for that. It's basically, instead, as you go device to device, you may still have, you know, 100 devices connected to a network, but the network is not connected to the internet, and you don't want to have a proxy or anyway, so you really can't get out. So there is actually a way to use our secure offline update, a mechanism to update these 100 devices from a local server. Good. So that really makes it much easier for your technicians or many times for the end customers. This stuff is really designed and your end customer could do that. Okay, now let me walk you through a demo where you can really see how that works, all the different stages we talked about. So let me get the video started here. Okay, so that's our web interface. You see here, that's Lockbox. That's the one we manage our offline updates. You can see here there are already a lot of tests. So we say we're going to have an OS update for the Polis IMX 8. And you also want to have application package, you know, a Docker compose file, several Docker containers update. Now here, you can select different OSs. Choose one here, and then a Docker compose file. It's basically the application. We choose here, you can have versions. Now you can see here which version we installed, 5, and that we need to give it a name. So it's basically the name of the lockbox where you put all the update in. In our case, OS update and application update. You can also just update one if you like. Now it's creating the lockbox here. And you can also see in the background, there are a lot of other ones. You can, you know, say, no, this is not valid anymore. You know, it's an expired date. You can change and so on. So now we say we're going to make a USB stick or an SD card. So at the moment, we get here a comment and we copy that and we go now to our host PC where we have our Torizon Core Builder installed. We put that comment in there and you can see now it downloads all the update thing. Like the OS update, you know, the metadata, it also gets all the containers down and basically creates a folder where all this is ready. And now we have here a USB stick connected. You can see it here, there. Not just my coworker who did the demo for me. And we will copy that over. So we have our update folder, which Torizon Core created, and we will copy that over to the USB stick. Okay. Now here we have a system running, which is rebooted here. You can see it's booting up. It goes into a browser, which is just a demo. It goes into a browser and shows our main website. Now we actually we simulate an offline thing. So we disconnect the Ethernet, we connect the USB stick, and now in the background, the offline update is running. It's updating this system. And if you would have another system, you're not allowed, it wouldn't do it. If there's different updates on that stick, it will choose the right one. So that's very good. So it did update. it basically reboots the system because you had an OS update. There you have to do a reboot. So it comes up and it will show our developer website. But for the demo, it's a little bit of funny demo. So we use the website as a demo and you want to show offline updates. Of course, it's not connected now. Renato just connected the Ethernet here again. And we can refresh the page and you can already see the developer.toradex.com. So before we were on the main website, now we are on the developer website. And by the way, they're on the top. That line, the green bar there, that's how you get to the new device. So that's basically how that works. Very simple. Go on the developer website. Go on Torizon, create your lockboxes. You can manage them, delete them. Put in whatever you want. Then you have the Torizon core builder creating that. You know, you have a USB stick going to the devices, and you know, doing updates. So pretty straightforward. Now the next thing is about kind of the mixed situation. So that's really possible. So maybe you're not ready for online update yet, but you can pre-provision your devices. So later you can get them online very, very easily. You can also use, of course, the offline update feature, to add online things that. And it's really designed to have a mixed fleet. So it's very common that people normally want to go remote updates, but then one of the reasons we had, for example, they have not all devices have cellular connectivity, or there are some other issues. Maybe one of the customers do not allow them to connect them. So many times customers have mixed fleet, and our system is really designed for that. Also, just coming back a little bit on Torizon here. So again, we were already talking a little bit, what we can do, but I can go a little bit about the features of Torizon Core. Is really the operating system you get. You don't need to build your own one. It's built with Yocto, so you can fully customize it. You do not need to use it, but you can. Then the integration with the IDEs to make that easy. Also, like Qt is actually easier to use with your studio. We use Docker. It allows our customers to tap into the Docker ecosystem. We have a lot of our own Docker container partner provide that, as you could see here. If you need a database or something, you could just use the standard. Remote updates, of course, talked a lot. Device monitoring. So when you deploy it, you can actually see what's going on. Let's say the temperature of your device, or you see, the new update, the CPU gets, load is way too high, or memory gets tight, whatever. Torizon Core Builder, I mentioned, you can really customize your device without needing Yocto, adding splash screen, adding other drivers, adapt for your own carrier board, a lot of possibility there. Do images for factory programming and so on. Then here's stuff mostly interesting for fleet manager. You can have different fleets. You can monitor, what's going on there. Of course, the offline update. We are working on remote access. It's not available at the moment. We expect that coming available later this year, which allows you, if your device is connected, it's not really working with just offline devices, you can connect, you can, log in, maybe troubleshoot, help your customer. And so that's it. And that's it. Extendability is what I mentioned, the API interface, so you can add your own, cloud solution, several ones, so you can extend it, you can connect with other systems. And you get all of that with Torizon. So if you start with Torizon about the offline update, that's what you're looking for. Very good, but you get much, much more. Also, again, a huge advantage from Torizon, it's integrated with the hardware. So we do the hardware up the stack. So everything here, it calls full stack because it's tested on our good. To get started, go to toradex.com/Torizon. That gets you access to the Torizon platform. Actually, the things I showed you today, it's a work in progress. It's very late. I mean, it basically works, but you need to test everything and I'll put it together. And it should be available in about 2 weeks. So we will send you a short notification when you really can do that. Offline updates yourself, but you can get your login for Torizon. There is documentation now on the developer website where you can read up how that works. You can contact us if you have any questions. And in about 2 weeks, you will be actually able to do that yourself. now we actually end up at the Q&A. So let me see if there are any questions. Okay. So the one is, can I use Torizon with other songs? And the answer is yes. You can. I think it's even, you know, already John open. It's really open source. So Torizon Core is built with open source technologies. So you can port that other to other system. And we do have customers who have Toradex hardware. They like Torizon and have other hardware. So they will bring it to that. So that's totally possible. It's a little bit work. And of course, you have to then test that. You also have partners and you who can help on that. Somebody asked here, you tell us that every 3 months will be a tested binary. Is there test reports and specification available for that? So what we currently have online is our issue tracker. So for Torizon Core, you can actually see the issues we're working on, also on our BSP. You can see when they were resolved, when we are working on them, and so on. So that's available today. Now I tell you what's coming. So we, of course, we have a lot of automated testing, integrated CI/CD. We can actually also help you if you're interested in that. And it generated a lot of test reports. And we are very actively want to bring that online, so you see much more in detail what we all tested, because you can already go online and we see let's say SPI, you know, works. You would see if you click on that, maybe I can actually, I'm not really set up for that. Okay, so if you go to any of our products, I just, you know, choose one here. And you go here, you can see kind of the state, the channel state it is. And if you click on it, you get a more detailed, you know, if there are any bugs known on that. So that's what we have. And what we will try to do next is really having that a little bit more detailed. Do we need to pay for a license or yearly fee to use the offline update mechanisms in Torizon? Yes, there is a fee, but the offline update is basically the smallest one. It's 2,400. You can use it. You basically get offline update, and I think that's kind of a killer deal. Do you provide Torizon on premise? So currently, there is no off-the-shelf product for a real on-premise a deployment. So if you have on-premise with device monitoring and everything, get in touch with us. So we really would like to learn more. However, what we can do is the offline update I showed you before. You can use that part, have it on a local server, and, you know, do the updates for that. So if you just look at OTA, that may fit your bill. I used the update lib from Torizon Windows C. I kind of use Torizon now. So if you use Windows C, you may know our Toradex update lib, which basically gives you feature on, you know, actually executing the update, but it doesn't do anything about security or anything like that. And I would say yes. So Torizon, really one actually of our initial reason we even start with that, is for an easy way to people who migrate from Windows 10 IoT Core or big Windows or Windows CE to Linux. So also the Visual Studio integration, all of that, .NET support is very good. It's really designed for that. And of course, you will get the offline update and online updates. Okay, so it's we don't use Torizon, but Toradex BSP 5.6 with Yocto. And ready solution for us to integrate and test. So if you, you know, familiar with Yocto, or you say you may don't want to use the containers, then that's also possible. So what we typically recommend is that your base, where you base your own Yocto on from, was our probably one of our reference image, maybe the minimal one, and that you kind of move that for to Torizon. And so you get a key features like OS3 and so on, and then you can use that. You do actually not need to use the containers. I would recommend it in most cases. But if you feel like, oh, I don't want to use that, you can, you know, you can use that, or you can do your Yocto build as you use and then use the updates there. So there is definitely a migration path. And again, very happy to talk about more in detail. I'm using Toradex ports with boot to Qt, can Torizon work with boot to Qt. So Qt is a really, really important partner of us, and Torizon is very is integrated with Qt. So if you use boot to Qt, I assume you do not really want to deal with the operating system. You want to focus on the application, and that's exactly what Torizon is for. So maybe you wouldn't use exactly boot to Qt, but you would use Torizon with a boot container, and I think that's actually very nice and get a lot of additional features. Most likely that will work for that. You can also get in touch with you, we'll help you. And then you I'm quite sure you will like that. Okay. Which frameworks of the three mentioned do you use already? Aha, there. So we used OS3 technology, I think that's right, and software update. And then of course we used that, Uptane with the TUF framework. That's the one. So here is a comment, again, it's not a question, but software updates are always encrypted. How are keys protected? So no, they're not encrypted, they're signed. So means you can actually see, well, let's say somebody robs the USB stick from you and looks at it, he can see what's on there. So encrypted, but he can tamper with it. So as soon as he would make any changes to it, it will not be accepted by the device. So you are protected against anybody tampering with your system or trying to get other software on it, but you are not protected, how we set it up by default if somebody actually wants to read out what's in that. That's something you can, of course, add, and it's kind of, you can do that layered inside. That's that. Where the keys are stored, you can have them in our, in our cloud. You can take them offline if you like.
If I can interject for just a moment on the question of keys, in general, the answer to how key management is handled is that it's handled according to the Uptane framework. So keys for signing software validity are defined by that framework. And when you start out, when you sign up for an account, they're kept online, but you have the option to rotate those offline and keep them yourself, as well as do things like set up multi-sig requirements. And all of that key management stuff is built right into the Uptane framework. So you don't have to worry about the complexities of setting up an X509 PKI, for example, or the how to deal with revocation on devices. It's every time a device gets an update, it also goes through the Uptane protocol, which updates its metadata about your trust and your key hierarchies. In general, you don't have to worry about it because the client takes care of it, but depending on your security needs, you have the option to create the signing infrastructure that works for you.
Thanks a lot, John, for that. That was John. He's helping me here out with the Q&A, and he's actually our security expert. If you have very questions, more going into detail, or your review on our documentation, we definitely can get you together with John. He knows way more in detail than I hear what's behind the scenes. Good. So there's a question about if it's only available for Yocto, somebody has an IoT, Windows IoT embedded device. No, it doesn't really work for that. However, again, if you are interested to move to Linux, and because we have .NET Visual Studio integration, that we would recommend, give that a try or talk to us, so maybe we can move you over. Can I update base system DLLs like a replace of SS? HDLL, yeah, you can update the whole thing. I think already Renato answered that for me. Some data needs to be migrated during an update. Is there a recommendation how to roll by migrate data? So if you follow our best practices and use the system as intended, you would restore your data. You don't want to touch on a certain place, so this wouldn't get overwritten. So of course, we don't want to delete everything, and I even brought that up as a disadvantage of a lot of other systems. We're running out here a little bit of time. Yeah, do you have OTA updates? Yeah, I think that's also clear. I think I touched most of the question. If you have more or I didn't get to your one, we will follow up by email. Also, please feel free to reach out directly to us, to our local offices, or we also have a community at community.toradex.com. Ask your questions. You have more security related thing. We are very happy, to talk about you, reviewing your particular needs, your particular use case. So we would be very happy to do that. So with that, thanks so much for your time here. I hope you learned something, and hope I hear from you on any of our other channels. Have a great day. Thank you. Bye bye.